So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 24/7. So guys, as most of you would be knowing that in this series, we discuss a set of 5 questions and after having special sessions for 2 days, we are getting back to our basic format of having 5 questions, right? So before moving to question number 1, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. So if you are watching a video for the very first time, then do not forget to hit the subscribe button and you can also click this bell icon and it can help you to stay notified whenever a new video comes up. You can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to answer them as soon as possible. Apart from that, since we are talking about queries, you can always post them on the videos in comments and we'll try to answer them either in the comments or by taking them up in the videos, right? So are you ready for question number 1? Here is your question number 1. I hope the screen is perfectly visible. This question says, in the country called Dholakpur, the central government is witnessing a drastic fall in tax collections. As the country is going through recessionary tendencies, government is thinking to take some immediate steps to compensate for this fall. Some of the steps that government can take are mentioned below. Which of the following do you think is the most suitable, right? So guys, you can pause the video here and check out all the options and then decide that which is the one that you want to choose as your answer, right? So moving ahead to the solution, and the correct option for this question is option A. Option A means government can ask the public sector enterprises to pay more dividend to their shareholders. See, this seems like an unlikely answer, right? Because they are asking public sector enterprises, which are controlled majorly by government, to pay more dividend to their shareholders. But one thing that you have to ask here is, who is the major shareholder in case of public sector enterprises? None other than the government itself. That is why they are asking, that they are saying to PSEs that you declare more dividends and we, being the major shareholders, major stakeholders, we are going to get a benefit and we can get revenues and we can compensate for the fallen tax collections, right? So that is why this is the correct option, right? In other options, you can see that there is something which makes them not suitable in this situation, right? So, second option says government can ask PSEs to pay lesser dividend to their shareholders. Obviously, government is going to face loss here, being the major shareholder. The third option says government is thinking to ask PSEs to hire new employees. If you hire new employees, undoubtedly, that might boost consumption in the future, but that is not an immediate step. The government wants an immediate step. And for hiring new employees, there has to be burden on the public sector enterprise because they have to bear more expenses, right? And same goes for the next option, which asks to pay higher salaries to the employees, which will boost consumption, right? After that, the last option says government is thinking to ask PSEs to pay lower salaries to their employees in order to curtail costs. Right, so paying lower salaries to the employees might add somewhat to the profitability of PSEs, but how is that going to reach to the government, right? So, and anyhow, paying lower salaries to employees is going to have a negative impact in an economy which is going through recession, right? So that is why the most suitable option here is A. See, obviously, there are repercussions related to this option as well. But here we have to think from the point of view of government. And if you guys have been reading newspapers, recently it was there in the news that government has been asking PSEs to declare larger dividends so that government can compensate for their losses. Right? So here you can see tax collections majorly falling this year. Government wants PSEs to declare higher dividends. Higher dividends will help government to fill the part of gap. So, but the point, okay, the point here is whether the PSEs, they are capable of declaring these dividends or not. What about their financial position? Would they be able to do that? So, we have to look at the profitability. See, PSEs, the problem with PSEs is that only a limited number of them are profitable, that too in certain sectors, like some strategic sectors like oil, gas, power, coal, where the presence of private players is less, and the private players, they are not competing with government sector. So in such strategic sectors, PSEs, they are performing good. So there are, but there is the number of good performing, or the number of strong performing PSEs is less, right? So that is why in a capital starved country such as India, might not be most efficient way of going about things, might not be an efficient way of putting pressure on PSEs and asking them to dig deeper and give money to the government, right? So lack of profit making PSEs also explains the slowdown in the dividend. So if PSEs are not paying good dividends, that automatically explains. So anyone is going to wonder, or that why are they not paying good dividends? Obviously, because they are not making much profits, right? And barring a few sectors, PSEs have a strong footing. They have been losing out to private players. So that is what I just told you. Except the strategic sectors, or except some certain sectors, most of the PSEs, they are not performing very good. Right, so that is why it is going to be a burden for them to declare higher dividends in order to pay the surplus to government. Right, so moving ahead to the next question. Okay, question number 2. This question says, following are some statements about zero brokerage model in India. Select the one or the ones which is or are correct. Right, 3 statements given to you, 5 options given to you. Right, so you can pause the video, check out the statements properly, and then decide with your answer. Moving to the correct option for second question, the correct option for this question is option D. Option D means that only 2 is correct. Just give me a second. Only 2 is correct, rest 1 and 3 not correct. Right? So option 1. It might seem like a correct statement, but why is it not true? So first of all, let us try to understand something about zero brokerage model. The name itself tells you that there is going to be zero brokerage. What is brokerage? Whenever you ask your broker to do or perform certain activity in stock market for you, then that broker charges you with a little fee, which is known as brokerage, right? So it is as simple as paying brokerage whenever you're buying a house, or whenever you're buying a second hand car, right? So whenever you buy or sell things, and there is an entity which helps you to find a suitor, in that case you pay certain amount to them, that is known as brokerage, right? The zero brokerage model, it tells you that the brokerage is zero. So this is a model which is getting popular day by day, especially in the spirit of pandemic. Starting from March, this model has been really popular, right? So usually brokerage charges are one of the major costs which are associated with trading in stock market. But now with the advancement of technology, and it has become very easy to buy and sell securities. You can just download a particular app which allows you to do so, and you can trade in securities, right? So there you do not need a broker to perform many activities for you. That is why you yourself can perform those jobs, right? So under the zero brokerage model, the brokerage is very less, and it is not there for certain activities, but on certain activities it is charged by the provider, right? So that is why absolutely no charges is not the correct statement. There are certain charges, but the point is their value is very less, the quantum is very less, so that the cost burden on the investor is reduced, right? So zero brokerage model. But we have to ask, is this model really sustainable, right? Okay, second statement, technology one major driving force behind it, absolutely correct. Third statement, which says this new model has resulted in many part-time discount brokers moving to many full-service brokers. So guys, if you remember, in one of the previous sessions we discussed the difference between a full-service broker and a discount broker. So if you're not aware of it, I'm going to tell you in brief, and if you want to learn it in detail, you can ask for that video's link in the comments. Right, so full service broker, as the name tells you, the broker carries out activities for you. Apart from that, also provides you with advice that which stock to buy, which not. So basically provides you with a lot of services, right? Whereas a discount broker, main job is execution. So the brain here is your own. The brain is investor. The discount broker only has to execute. Whereas in case of full service brokers, the brain can also be of broker who is advising the investor that buy this stock or sell this stock, right? So with this advent in technology, with the zero brokerage models coming up, basically they have reduced the need for a broker. Investors themselves are able to buy and sell securities. That is why their need for full service brokers is reducing. Okay, if there is someone who is totally unaware about stock market and needs someone to advise, a full service broker might be helpful. But for many investors, and especially for the Robin Hood investors, the young investors who are just trying to utilize their savings into stock market or earn little money, quick money through it, they themselves like to perform it, right? So apart from having the knowledge and expertise, it provides them with an adrenaline rush to deal in stock market themselves, right? So there's a certain kick in it for investors, right? So for them, a discount broker is enough, because they can themselves decide that what are the activities that they want to perform, right? And it might be possible that on deal of certain classes of assets, like if you are buying or selling stocks and you are taking delivery for it, then there might not be any charge for it. But if you are dealing in derivatives or complex products like derivatives, then there might be some charges, some transaction charges on it, right? So basically, zero brokerage model refers to a low cost model rather than an absolute no cost model, right? So the statement is not correct. It should have been reversed. With the advent in technology, with the rise of zero brokerage models, many full service brokers are turning to discount brokers because the need for them is reducing, their services is reducing, and investors, they themselves like to trade in markets, right? So moving ahead, I think we have discussed most of the things here. Zero cost brokerage become an attractive stock broking model in India, challenging the traditional full service model by cutting down cost for equity investors. Part of discount broking model pioneered by companies such as Zerodha. I think Zerodha is a very famous platform, right? Brokerage not the only charge involved in stock trading. So brokerage is not the only charge. The other costs that investor has to pay are like security transaction tax, stamp duty, and many others, right? So now, how to find a perfect broker for you, or find someone who can understand your needs and then guide you. If you want a full service broker, then it is good to go for a SEBI RIA, that is SEBI Registered Investment Advisor. And recently, if you remember, we have discussed about this, that SEBI has brought some stricter guidelines for them, that they have to be this much educated, they should have this much of experience, right? So then only they can become SEBI Registered Investment Advisor. So it's beneficial, or it's safer to go with them, right? So moving ahead to third question, here is your third question, which says, recently SEBI came out with some rules for InvITs who are thinking of going for preferential allotment. Okay, the question is not complete, but it is very simple. You have to select the correct statement in this regard, with regard to this new rules that SEBI came out with, right? Moving to correct option, and the correct option for this question is option E. Option E means it here refers to preferential allotment. Made will not be made to any person who has sold or transferred any units of the issuer during 6 months preceding the relevant date, right? First of all, let us clear our concepts, then we will get back to the statement. Okay, I hope you remember what are InvITs, discussed many times in our sessions. Simply, it is like a mutual fund which collects money from from a number of investors and then takes that money, pulls it up, collects it up, and then puts it into some investment avenues that are going to invest that money into some infrastructural projects, right? So money that goes into infrastructure by taking funds from a large number of investors, large number of small investors, right? So that is InvITs. After that, what is preferential allotment? Usually when companies, they need money, what do? They come up with IPO, they raise money from public and then promise to provide them back some reward in the form of interest or dividends, depending upon what securities are they issuing, right? So preferential allotment is also a way to raise money by companies. If a company needs money, and if it needs it really quickly, it does not have the time to get into the formalities of an initial public offering or going into some or other options which are going to take much time, they can go for preferential allotment. This means issuing shares to a selected number of individuals, right? Selected number of investors, not individuals, investors. So process of issuing shares to selected people based on criteria set by the company. So they can, usually they are institutional investors, usually they are the investors who have expertise in the field of finance, who are not beginners and who cannot be duped very easily, right? So this is preferential allotment. Now any infrastructural investment fund that wants to go for preferential allotment, it has to follow a new rule by SEBI, according to which if there is any entity and that entity in the past 6 months, that entity has sold or transferred the shares of that company which wants to issue the which wants to come up with preferential allotment, they cannot do it to such entity. Okay, let's try to understand this with the help of an example. There is a company called X Limited. X Limited wants to raise money and wants to do it quickly. That is why it thinks of going for preferential allotment. Now there is an investor, Mr. A. But X Limited cannot allot any shares to Mr. A because, let's say X Limited is thinking of doing it on January 1, right? And Mr. A has sold some of the shares of this X Limited on, let's say, November 1, right? So in past 6 months, it has sold or transferred some shares of the issuer company. That is why, by the mode of preferential allotment, shares cannot be allotted to this particular entity, right? Person belonging to sponsors sold or transferred their units of the issuer. So units of the issuer. So here, not shares, but units, because we are talking about InvITs. During the 6 months preceding the relevant date, that is going to be ineligible for the allotment of units on preferential basis, right? So I hope you are clear about the concepts of REITs and InvITs. So just as InvITs invest the money collected into infrastructural projects, REITs does it in real estate or property, right? So SEBI came up with guidelines regarding these two investment methods in 2014. These are becoming popular in India now, right? But still their growth is very slow and there is only a limited number of REITs and InvITs that have registered it, that have become operational in India. So guys, there's a homework for you. You have to research about some REITs and InvITs which are working in India and mention it in the comments, right? So I hope to see a lot of answers. Moving ahead to next question. Okay, question number 4, which says Mr. Rahul Modi is thinking to sell his business to Mr. Gaitonde's company called Ganpati Enterprises. Now the acquiring company does not intend to close the business down, and assets and liabilities of business are being sold as an undertaking to Ganpati Enterprises. Assets and liabilities not being individually sold, but to Ganpati Enterprises as one undertaking. But instead of cash, Gaitonde is going to pay in the form of shares to Modi. Which of the following words would perfectly describe this transaction or this situation. Moving ahead to the correct option. And the correct option for this question is option C, that is slump exchange. Right? So slump is a common word in mergers and acquisitions transaction. So very simple, whenever one part, there is one company, let's say this company is called A Limited. A Limited is selling a part of their business to X Limited, but they're not selling assets and liabilities as an individual. Like the valuation is being done as an enterprise rather than assets and liabilities being individually valued, right? So as an enterprise, let's say they are selling their business to a part of their business. Let's say the entire business, A Limited is selling their entire business to X Limited for, let's say, rupees 100 crores, right? So in that case, this is going to be known as a slump sale. When the assets and liabilities, they are not individually priced, but they are sold as an entity. They are valued as an entity. A value or a price tag is put up to this particular entity as one, right? They are being sold to another company. Then it is known as a slump sale. But when this company, if it pays in cash, then obviously it is a slump sale. But if this company offers not to pay in cash, but with some other securities, some shares, then it is going to be known as a slump exchange, right? Here you can see, instead of cash, Gajonde is going to pay in the form of shares. That is why this is a slump exchange, not a slump sale, right? So this is slump exchange. Some more information about slump exchange. You can see here, means transfer of whole or part of undertaking. So it can be a part of business as going concern. Going concern means that the acquirer is not having any intentions to shut this business down, but they are going to run it or they are going to operate it. So the going concern principle is being followed. Going concern means you are not expecting to close down the business, right? So as a result of the sale for a lump sum consideration, consideration is being received as one payment, not by installments, without individual values being assigned to assets and liabilities. Simple words, qualify as a slump sale. What are the criteria? Business must be sold as a whole. Business is sold as a going concern. See, if it is not a slump sale, it might be possible the acquirer is buying some particular assets, not the entire business. But here, in case of slump sale, the entire business is being sold. Business is being sold as going concern. No intention to close it down. Individual item-wise values are not given to the assets transferred. Sale is made for a lump sum consideration. Payment is being done in one go rather than in installments, right? See, although the valuation is not done on the basis of assets and liabilities, but there might be possible that in order to fulfill some legal formalities, some values of some assets are being defined, right? But that is still going to be a slump sale, because that the valuation of assets and liabilities, it is being done just to make the formalities or just to fulfill the formalities, right? Not in order to put a value or not in order to provide a choice to the buyer that you can buy this asset, you can buy this liability or not, right? So no choice to seller, has to buy the business as a whole, right? Slump sale considered to be one of the most preferred ways of carrying out a deal due to various tax and stamp duty implications that are associated with it. So this is considered one of the easiest way, because obviously you do not have to define the values of assets and liabilities individually. Apart from that, it provides many times benefits of tax saving, because the entire business is sold in one go. See, it might be possible that when assets and liabilities, they are sold off as an individual, some can possess short-term gains, some can possess long-term gains, and usually the tax on short-term gains is higher than the long-term tax on long-term gains. But when you sell individual business as a whole, then if that business is 36 months old, then it is going to be 36 months old with the buyer, then it is going to be considered as a long-term gain. So there might be some assets which might possess some short-term gain, but that is not considered because the business is being sold as one entity, right? So only the age of business is considered, not the age of entire assets and liabilities to determine the tax, right? So that is why that might lead to tax saving. Slum sale mainly affected by the way of BTA, that is business transfer agreement, just like a document containing all the information related to it. Consideration for a slum sale has to be in cash. If it is in securities, transaction be called an exchange, not a sale. That is why the correct answer for our question was slum exchange, right? So guys, now there is one more homework for you. So there is a Kolkata based company which is facing some problems currently, and it engaged in slump exchange in 2019, and now its creditors are raising some sort of issues, right? So you can easily find about it in recent Live Mint. So I hope to see the name of this company, which is this Kolkata based company. Let's see who gives the correct answer, right? Moving ahead to the last question for today, question number 5th, which says, recently an RBI panel has suggested conversion of existing large NBFCs into banks. What do you think is the objective of central bank behind this step? Very simple question, too much in news. Moving ahead to the solution, and the correct option for this question is option B, to infuse funds into capital starved Indian banking sector. So recently one deputy governor of RBI gave a statement that large NBFCs, they should be converted into banks, and we should allow the entry of large conglomerates into Indian banking sector. So basically there is one working paper which RBI has come up with, and it has put up the recommendations for taking suggestions and feedback from different entities, and if these recommendations they go through, they will result in opening up the Indian banking sector for NBFCs and for large conglomerates like Tata or Adani, or right? Okay, here are some suggestions. Cap on promoter stake in the long run, which was 15%. So a promoter in the long run could have only 15% of its entity if it is working in the banking sector. Now it is being recommended to be increased to 26%. That means more control of promoter over the management. Promoter is going to have a higher voting power, right? Large corporates, industrial houses allowed to be promoters of banks only after necessary amendments in Banking Regulation Act and strengthening of supervisory mechanism for large conglomerates. Okay, a lengthy point, but simply it means that we should allow large companies to become banks or to open banks, right? And also central bank needs to have a stricter regulatory mechanism for them, right? Because see, if private players are getting into banking, then there are more chances of some scams happening or regulations and loopholes being misused. So that is why allowing this needs simultaneous strengthening of regulation, right? After that, well-run NBFCs with asset size of 50,000 crore or more, they should be, including those which are owned by corporate houses, may be considered for conversion into banks subject to completion of 10 years of operation. If they are 10 years old and their asset size is more than 50,000 crore, they can be converted into banks. So this is very important because this is going to lead to an increase in competition for Indian banking sector, right? Minimum initial capital requirements, they are to be enhanced from 500 crore to 1000 crore, and for universal bank. Guys, we have discussed what is the meaning of universal bank in one of our previous videos. A bank that performs almost all the jobs, and from 200 crore to 300 crore for small finance banks. So minimum capital that they should have, their limits are to be increased. So these are recommendations. Let's see how many of them go through. So there are some more, but these are some major recommendations. Going back to the question. Increase governmental control. No, if private players are allowed, then government control is definitely going to decrease. It's not the correct option. Protect banking sector by reducing systemic risk. If NBFCs are allowed to convert into banks, systemic risk not going to be reduced but going to be increased if not regulated properly. Shed small size Indian banks from competition by NBFCs. So this is going to increase their competition. That is why not the correct answer. Reduce the control of promoters. Promoters control is going to increase. So the correct option is this. Why is RBI thinking to do this? Because Indian banking sector, it needs money. It needs capitalization that big businesses have. That is why they are being, it is being thought that we should allow entry of their entry into the banking sector. So there are pros and cons of it, but let's see what goes through, right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. If you did, then do not forget to hit the like button before you leave. So I'm going to discuss some doubts here. Okay, there was an article which was asked by Ria Verma, and that article is called, just give me a second. Okay, that article is called Government Interest Relief May Add to Your Tax Liability. So this was an article which was published in LiveMint, and okay, it included information. So guys, if you remember, I told you in one of the sessions that government has taken up the duty to bear the interest on interest of the borrowers that was being charged by banks, right? So that, and they were giving them back to the people who have already paid it. So basically, this money might add to the income of people who have already paid to the interest, but that might add to their tax liability. Why is that so? Because see, if there is an extra income, you have to show it somewhere in your ITR, in your income tax return. And the confusion is, where is this money going to go? Under which heading? Because under the heading that it goes, that is associated with the rate of tax that is going to be charged on it. So for most of the borrowers, this money is going to be charged at a good rate, at a high rate of interest, which might add to the tax liability of the receiver, right? So this is what this article summarizes. Okay, so okay, this was one doubt by Ria. Okay, another by Piyush Gupta, which says, what happens when any bank write off its NPAs? Is it profitable for the bank? How is it going to be profitable for the bank? Bank is not receiving the money back that it has lent, right? So it is basically a loss for the bank, because bank is not able to recover the amount that it has already given to some borrower. That is why it is a loss for the bank, and obviously its creditworthiness is affected, its image is affected, its credit rating is affected. So lots of things, lots of problems associated with it apart from the financial distress. Okay. Okay, and there was one more question, just give me a second. Okay, so guys, these were the doubts. So I hope you found this information beneficial, and I'll see you in the next session. Till then, you take care of yourself, keep your studies going on, and thank you for being here.